Bernardo is here. Look at Bernardo, what a smile on his face. He's ready for a great night. Tonight, we're gonna meet with a very legendary new friend and media consultant, Elliot Mitz. Elliot has been by far one of the most honorable, special, brilliant people I met. And I'm very, very pleased to meet somebody that is so good in what he does, but also so smart and have such great values for life. Bernardo, do you mind to bring a bottle of...
Sure.
A bottle of water, maybe. Okay, oh, you know, we have to, he has water.
Okay. I think we can go in.
Hello. Hi. Hi. Hi.
You look exquisite. You look exquisite. Let me first give you a hug.
How are you doing?
How are you doing?
So good to see you.
Good to see you.
You met fabulous Sharon?
I have met the fabulous Sharon. Can I look at you in the light?
Yeah.
Oh, fabulous. The makeup is grand. The hair is grand.
Guess who did my hair?
Hair by Sharon?
I did it. No, I'm kidding.
Makeup by Sharon.
I didn't do anything.
Hair by my towel.
What is that supposed to be? Oh, it's just a little color.
What is this fantastic sound? Why work so hard? Life's a road and we don't know where to start. How long do we drive? Thank you, Elliot. It's a pleasure.
Same for me. And I love what you're wearing. How would you describe what you're wearing?
A blend of kind of a little bit royalty mixed with 80s kind of, it's tasteful and it's also a little bit of in bad taste, which I kind of like to mix.
Among those things that you just mentioned, tell me the part of you that you see as being kind of royal?
Well, to start with, if you're talking from a point of view of outside design or fashion, I just like the color gold. And I like shine and yellowish. And I just like the art of the king and the queen from the old days, from Marie Antoinette.
Do you see yourself as a kind of regal figure? Would it be fair to say, and I don't want to put words in your mouth, that if I was to ask you what era you identify with most, what decade musically, culturally stimulates you the most, would it be the 80s?
I think in the 80s, from all I know, because, I mean, I was a kid, a little kid in the 80s. However, I think it was sort of a liberation. I mean, after the 70s, it just seems like the 80s were a combination of new electro sound. It was when the electro sound was starting, and then the atmosphere was just very creative and liberating. It was right after the sexual revolution. Women became more empowered, and I think it was an interesting timing when people were just still very excited to live before the AIDS hit and kind of damaged our ability to be more free sexually.
I'm going to talk with you a lot about sex tonight.
Oh, that's perfect. It's my favorite subject.
What about you? Not just in clothing, but in your music, your performance, your writing, your attitude, and as a woman, is in bad taste.
Well, I wouldn't call it bad taste, but I just like to leave a little bit of door for being not perfect in anything that I do. I'm very perfectionist. Half of my sign is I'm a Virgo Leo. I just feel like there's so many expectations these days from us as individuals in the modern world after everything became so advanced. So I always like in my art and just as a human, just to kind of bring a little bit of humor or just a place for it to be not perfect. And that not perfect, this place for unperfectionism always just bring a little bit of like, just it might be a little bit really not matching or just something a little bit funny about it.
Name four things that you were imperfect.
Imperfect? Well, you know, my body is not, I mean, my body is perfect for me, but this part of my body is bigger, my pelvic and my ass. So, I mean, guys would say it's perfect, but however, when I dress up, I would need to kind of make sure that I'm wearing the right things that's going to flatter my body in that way. Besides that, I'm really perfect. And quality-wise, I mean, I think, I'd like to study for a few years about history and art and trans and science. And it's not going to make me more perfect, but just for my kind of, for what I want to know about the world. And I'm just curious about more things. So, and besides that, I mean, I don't know, I'm not too hard on myself.
You're not too hard on yourself, but if I was to ask most women I know about their shortcomings or their imperfections, few would be as bold to volunteer that they have an issue with their body, mm-hmm. that their body parts that they don't like. You're an extraordinarily attractive woman, and part of the popularity that you have already garnered, obviously, has a lot to do with the way you look. And obviously, lots of people love the way you look. How big an issue is that the area that you referenced, your what you described as a larger pelvic area mm-hmm. and a slightly larger Kardashian area, does that trouble you? Does it bother you? Do you think about that?
Oh no, I don't think about it. I mean, I like to talk about it because I like to challenge people to just not try to be perfect. I think it's if I can do anything to help as an artist or somebody that is open about themselves, just to encourage people to see their vulnerabilities or their flaws and the things that they don't feel so proud of, to make fun of themselves. Because yeah, of course, I mean, the first thing that most of the guys would say, oh, you have a great ass.
That's what most of them
yeah, and that's great, so I don't have any problem with that. But it's also something that I'd like to say out loud because I'm not perfect, I shouldn't be perfect, none of us are perfect, and our unperfectionism and our flaws are part of what makes us special and beautiful.
If you could wave the magic wand tomorrow and make yourself look visually exactly the way you wanted to see yourself, would you lift the wand and make changes, or would you leave the wand where it is and be proud of the way you look?
I'd probably leave the wand.
You'd probably leave the wand on the table.
Yeah. I mean, I think I'm a very lucky girl. I can't deny, I mean, I like the way that I look. I've been lucky. I was born beautiful. So I always thought that I'm beautiful, but I worked on myself over the years so I can feel beautiful and love my body and accept myself as I am.
Is it fair to say that one of the, quote, messages that you want to impart upon other young women, and perhaps young men, is that they should delight in their physicality, the way they are, as opposed to make efforts to change
it? Yeah, absolutely. I mean, when you walk, the commercials, I mean, us as living in the modern world and being exposed all the time for the consumers, for the advertisers, for nonstop commercials of everyone is just trying to sell everything, including themselves, to everyone. I think we went a little bit too advanced by chasing all kinds of images that are stuck in our heads from the media. It has a few reasons, from the technology evolution to the availability of porn online, for all kinds of different, for different reasons, we have those new images of what women and men should look like, and we all just working really hard to kind of just imitate that image. And this new image, it's probably started from sometimes in the 90s, I'd say. So it was an evolution from the very, very skinny body of the models to being skinny, and then also starting embracing your body and changing your body with plastic surgeries. And when I go and train with trainers these days, it's pretty rare you don't meet a trainer that will tell you after a week or 2 weeks or 3 weeks, they would be very concerned about what you're eating. Mm-hmm. And then they say, well, then you won't change your body. And I always ask them, why do I need to change my body? Like, I mean, I love being in good shape. I love working out. Of course, we can always be leaner and taller and skinnier and what's not and fatter. But why do we need to change all the time? Like, what are we chasing after? I always find myself in the same conversation with a trainer, and I really preferably just always like to work out with people who do not unconsciously start giving me feeling like there's something wrong with my body. I always say, when people say, oh, how can I find a good trainer? What type of workout should I do? And I always say, well, the first very important thing when you work out with somebody else is the stream of the unconscious thoughts.
The stream
of the unconscious thoughts that the trainer has. If he's engaging you and giving you and letting you the feeling that there is something wrong with your body, most likely you won't change your body, because your body will be so stressed out and would feel self-hatred. So the body won't be able to change.
So you go to the gym. You have a personal trainer. You work out every day for health reasons, for cardio reasons, to keep your heart strong.
Yeah, also because I love it. I've been an athlete my whole life. I was a swimmer.
But I want to make this distinction, because mm-hmm. some people would consider it a conflict. They would say, if she believes that everybody should be happy with their bodies the way it is,
No, I love working out. I'm an athlete, hyperactive person.
You like the sensation of being...
Well, I was a swimmer when I was 13. I was a competitive swimmer in my home country. And in 2 years, I won my third in the country.
When you were mentioning the issues, the new perception that we have of the way men and women look, you mentioned pornography. Mm-hmm. We've established the fact that you're a sexually liberated woman. So, first, do you watch pornography?
Rarely. Probably, I mean, there would be like periods of times, but not often, really. I don't need that to get, I don't need, I'm sexual enough, I don't need it.
Do you think that the pornographic stars, whoever, the biggest, most famous stars in that medium, that their body types perpetuate this stereotype that you were addressing earlier?
Well, I think there is definitely very large increase in the amount of plastic surgeries since 2000. And porn became available online sometimes, what, in the 90s? Late 90s, 2000?
I think so.
And I really see a connection between it, between just porn being available online and everyone can see it, kids can see it. And I think it helps modifying this image that we have about the perspective of men and women body.
You said it helps modify. What do you mean by that?
I mean, it just encouraged people to delude themselves that people really look like that.
Got it. So your objection to pornography is not the act of men and women having sexual experiences that are shared with other people. Your objection to pornography is that the people depicted in them conform to a certain perfection body type. That's what you find offensive.
Yeah, I find, and I don't blame it on pornography. I just think that it's the whole, like, the overall media images that we have and we consume. So that fake body stereotype that we all have in our mind, based on just something we can never born like. It's almost like it's kind of started as a nice joke. It's like, oh, great, let's you know, a few people would get a little bit of fake things and look a little bit more glamorous and more beautiful. But now we became jokes because we were trapped in that delusion of body and look that is almost unrealistic to achieve unless you go to the doctor and get anesthesia and cut yourself.
Cut yourself.
Yeah, get cut. That's what people do.
So you use the phrase cut yourself as a synonym for cosmetic surgery, liposuction.
I mean, yeah, unfortunately, when we get to when we need to have a heart operation, we also cut our body in half. It looks very peculiar to everyone, and everyone is concerned. But when a girl's going to the doctor to cut her titties, everyone seems totally fine with it. it doesn't bother anyone.
When you look at men, how important is their physicality, their physical appearance to you?
I think the whole beauty about men is that they're kind of not paying a lot of attention to the way they look. This is part of man charm, to be not perfectionist about the way he looks. So, of course, a man should be aesthetic and look decent for whatever decent is it is. It's a matter of taste. But part of the beauty and part of what makes men sexy is not being so aware and conscious about the way they look. I think that's more a feminine quality, or at least used to be.
Do you know that some men get calf implants to make their legs look mm-hmm. more athletic? Men who try to enhance themselves, or as you say, cut themselves, the cosmetic surgery, you find that as disturbing as the women who try to do that?
Yeah, I mean, it's the same thing. It's not that I'm criticizing the individuals who are doing it. I think it's more an epidemic that happens in our society that we're not really admitting, and people are kind of not admitting and putting finger on it because it's, of course, very financial, profitable for a lot of people. And at the same time, a lot of people that are in the media trying to pretend they were just born like that. So it's kind of an inconvenient subject to talk about. But the truth is, I feel it's kind of bigger issue than we are admitting. And I think it puts the younger generation in very conflicted and not healthy environment with just bad thoughts and bad feelings about themselves growing up. The thing is, I understand when people, when they cross, let's say, a woman cross the age of 50, or a woman had 3 kids or 4 kids. I can understand that, but I can't understand why 17, 18, 16, or 20, or even 30-year-old should go to the doctor, and why women that do not want to go to the doctor need to feel bad about themselves.
You were born in Israel. You lived most of your life in Israel before you came here.
Right.
For people who might be watching this, is there something magical about the Holy Land? Do we over-romanticize Israel? When you think of your country, when you think of the way you were raised, share your thoughts.
I mean, I think Israel is definitely a very magical place.
Why?
Well, part of it, of course, it's the history and the idea that it was a desirable place and a holy place for so many religious. Of course, in America, there are also so many religious, and so many people live here from so many religions, and the same when you just looking at the majority of the world, just because the world today is very global, so people are moving around. However, in Israel there are so many holy places that belong to all the different religions, or to the some of the 3 main religions. So that's for that reason. But if you're there, as soon as you land in Israel, you just feel kind of the heat in the air, the magic. You just have something beautiful about it. Very energetically, it's gorgeous. When it comes to the culture of the Israeli culture, it's very ambivalent. On one hand, you feel the magic in the air. On the other hand, Israel is very tense, it's very modern, and it's fast-paced. And people are pretty, you can say blunt, you can say aggressive, depending what day and what hour and who you're dealing with.
Your earliest recollection, little girl in Israel, your earliest recollection that there was something about you, Meital, that was different?
I was in the bathtub, and I was a really young girl, and I just remember that I probably didn't, I'm not sure if I even knew how to talk at that age, but I remember I was kind of talking in English and actually being interviewed. And my dad is saying that when I was a few months old, maybe, or in a very young age, he has that image of me, he's getting into the bathtub, and he see me, and I'm looking at him, and he said, and he heard some kind of, I was making some weird noises, I don't know. And then he said, when I was looking at him, I just looked like an alien or somebody who came from another planet. But it's weird because we both have a similar memory that related to an early age in a bathtub. So I'm not sure if we both, if it was the same, we shared the same moment, or maybe.
Did you really feel that you were doing an interview in the bathtub?
I just have like a vague recollection of a moment like that.
You were in Israel. You were in the bathtub. You were 2 years old, and you were giving an imaginary interview.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think you saw something in your future?
Maybe, because I remember it was in English. And of course everyone, I mean, not everyone, but the Israelis in Israel talk Hebrew. So I was talking Hebrew at that age, if I was talking at all.
But the imaginary interviewer in the bathtub was speaking English.
Mm-hmm. All in English, yeah.
I find that fascinating. Do you believe in destiny?
I tend to believe in destiny because I see how people in life are so powerless. It seems like we're so advanced and can do so many things and control so much. And we can more so than we could a while back. So we can control more and more and more and more, but we're still really just powerless. Every day you can get up and die. In every moment you can die. You can die from anything. So I guess there is a higher power, and for that reason I guess there is a destiny.
I asked the question because I've never met anybody who said when I was 2 years old I was in the bathtub and I had an imaginary conversation with an English interviewer. In other words, there's something about that, and perhaps I, as usual, read more into these things as I should. But could it have been a statement about your destiny that you were going to grow up to reach a point in your life where you are now, where English-speaking people with microphones are interviewing you mm-hmm. about your life? Do you read that, or?
Yeah, I mean, I was thinking about it. This is not something I forgot about. I remembered it. As I was growing up, I was always just curious about it.
What was your early life? You were raised with two brothers in Israel. Your mom was an artist. Your dad, entrepreneurial. What was life like? What are your earliest recollections of it as a little girl growing up?
I just remember I was a very observing child. So I was very sensitive for everything, and I just mainly remember everything not so much as experiencing, but more kind of as a fly on the wall, just seeing everything and observing and thinking. And I spent a lot of time with my brothers, and my older brother raised me, while my younger brother, I kind of raised him, but I was telling him a lot of terrifying stories and making bad jokes.
What, like,
I would take
terrifying?
I would take a knife from the kitchen and I would be like, oh, like this, and then I would hold the knife and pretend that I'm dead. Like, I would do just make jokes and stories about the neighborhood and what's happening, and he would be like, he would be my project.
Do you know the expression tomboy or tomgirl?
Tomboy, yeah.
Were you a tomboy?
Maybe.
How'd you do in school?
I was very shy, so I always felt like nobody really noticed me. But when I was 12, all the guys did, it was the first confession. So all the guys, except for one guy in the class, they all said they love me. So I couldn't be happier.
Was it a happy childhood?
Not so much. I was actually very, I was kind of depressed as a kid.
Why? Tell me about that.
I observed a lot of what happened with my mother's family and my grandmother. She was a sculptor and she died pretty early at the age of 60. So I had to go through that with my mom. And the relationship between my dad and my mom, and I was just carrying all these feelings and all this information about everyone. So I think it was emotionally pretty heavy.
When did you discover boys?
I remember I was, so at the age of 12, when everyone confessed they loved me, of course I was really happy. But very much after, at the age of 13, I moved to the school where it was a bigger school it was kind of like not a college, but more a school in the area that has more villages, more students from more villages coming to learn in that school. So all of a sudden there would be girls that were blonder and like more beautiful. And I used to have those two braids.
And it was pigtails?
Yeah.
Yes.
Pigtails, braids, like long braids. And I was so shy that I would never even shake the braids or do anything with it until I got my courage at the age of 13 and I cut my hair by myself. So when I went to this new school, I came with a frizzle hair and I just... That was very frustrating. And I was so... my main goal at the age of 13, after we moved to the bigger school, my main goal really was to get laid. That's what I wanted more than anything else in my life. And it seems forever, like it seems it's never gonna happen. I remember it was already 14 and some other girls got pregnant in school, and I remember I was actually jealous of them that they got pregnant at the age of 14.
Now, there are two things on the table here. One was that at 14, you were jealous of other girls who had gotten pregnant. Mm-hmm. And the other was that you were seeking the amorous advance of a young man. I understand the first. I'm confused about the second. Isn't he young? I mean, I don't want to say fossilized, but I mean...
Yeah, it's young. I was just a passionate girl.
Yeah.
It just was something that I was thinking about.
Are Israeli,
and that occupied my mind.
Are Israeli girls maybe a little bit more...
advanced.
Yeah, or active, or...
Well, yes, but I don't know if they're... necessarily would lose the virginity earlier, but I think I was just, I still am a sexual person, so it just occupied my mind.
You lose your virginity at age 15 to one of three suitors.
Mm-hmm. It wasn't a big battle.
May have been for them.
It was a cheap date.
Was it a rewarding, memorable, life-affirming experience?
Sex is one of the most essential thing in our life as human. So not necessarily the first time, but
I was asking about your first experience.
Yeah, I think the first experience, just like the rest of the experiences for the most part.
Most women, young women, 13, 14, 15, 16, when they recall their first experience, it was not all that memorable and wonderful. That's at least what's been reported to me. In your case, it was.
Yeah, I mean, I was 15 and a half, and I wouldn't say dating, but I was seeing this guy, he was 30.
30?
Yeah.
Twice your age?
We had great times.
Yeah.
So I kind of liked him, and it was very, like, interesting, and I was just very happy to get over with it, finally get into action. And just when all the action started, I went, when I was 16, I went on a foreign exchange student program to West Virginia and Idaho.
Your first trip to America.
Mm-hmm.
What was that like?
West Virginia, I stayed with an older couple house, and it was a very funny experience. Just learned a lot about the American society, more kind of as a spy, just because I was very young, and I went right into just places like little town, a student town, Moscow in Idaho, and St. Albans in West Virginia, which is just very random cities in America. So just seeing the youth and the people in high school, what they do and how they are. And so I think I learned a lot.
Did you like America immediately? Did you feel a homesickness for Israel? What was it that you liked about the country? And what was it that you felt was kind of weird?
America feels like the land of opportunity, just like the myth. In the same times, it feels like an old cowboy movies, kind of like, just be careful not to get shot as you ride your horse, you know? So I think it was the same experience in the essence of it as a younger kid, and just as an older, you know, not, I can't say older woman, but an older girl.
People were friendly and open to you? You had a good rapport with them?
I think probably people were more friendly to me when I came back.
I'm talking about the first trip.
The first trip. They were pretty much saw me as an Israeli, like pretty much as a girl from another country. So they were nice. I was friends of the home queens, and at least in West Virginia.
but you were more of a kind of social oddity. You said they saw you as an Israeli.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was more just like reading a tag on your shirt, like, oh, Maytel from Israel, okay. The Israeli girl.
You went back to Israel. I read notes on you and biographical information that we're going to get into when I talk to you about my impressions of you. And there were two things that jumped off of the information that I read about you. You went back to Israel and you became a competitive swimmer and you became a soldier in the Israeli army.
Mm-hmm.
At what age did you begin to swim, and at what age were you certain that you could swim competitively?
Well, the swimming was at age 13.
That's when you started to swim.
But I swam only for 2 years. Only 2 years I won ski and left.
Why did you not pursue swimming?
My parents told me they didn't want me to become bulky.
Bulky?
Yeah, they recommended me not to swim. And at that age, I mean, I was actually kind of, I mean, I don't know, I felt too shy almost to be a swimmer, and I better be an actor.
You
because the swimming embarrassed me a little bit. socially. I just needed, I think I needed to find an outlet for all my emotions, because, and everything that was going on in my mind. I guess I was destined to be an actor or an artist, so performer artist. So there was an urge inside me to start studying acting, but it really just happened because I was doing the swimming, and then I didn't do that. So we knew a girl that went to that acting school close to my, in a city close to my village.
And tell me about your entering the world of acting, your first experiences. What was the name of the acting school?
Well, I would always act, so I would act since I really was a kid. But I won't act just in social environment. Like, I wouldn't be the type of girl that would start dancing in the living room or singing in the living room or anything like that. But in front of a lot of people, I would feel I would all of a sudden come and do some kind of a skit or a song and entertain the public. So I'll start that in school. And then I started studying it in Netanya, in an acting school at the age of 13. And then when I didn't act for half a year when I came to America. So when I came back to Israel, my main conclusion from the trip was actually that I want to become, that I want to pursue the acting in a professional way.
And you did, with enormous success, did you not? Mm-hmm. You don't have to brag, just give me the details. You weren't just another student in an acting class. Tell me how far your acting went.
So when I was 17, I had that, the whole like moment of just realizing where my life is gonna take me and just making the master plan for my life, sitting in a little bar in Tel Aviv. And basically I decided to go for it. So the first I started, I went to one of, the biggest acting school in Israel, and I studied there when I was 17. Then I was accepted to this military unit that is really hard to get in. I know it sounds ridiculous, like Israeli thing, but it's real. It's a unit in the military, because military is mandatory for male and female in Israel. So I was part of the theater of the army. So at the age of 18, I was already started working with top directors from the theater, at least in Israel. And the creative director of the theater that I was actually belonged to later on when I graduated acting school. That was my first kind of door that was open for me in the Israeli industry of entertainment. From that, I got scholarships for my acting school, for this, the most prestigious acting school in Israel. And as I was studying acting, I already started working in film, theater, and TV.
So you took 2 weeks of what we call in America basic military training?
Correct.
You know how to fire a rifle?
I don't know, but I can try. Do you have one?
But
I did. I learned. Yeah. I learned how to shoot a gun. And then I entertained the troops. I always have that joke and we're from between the bullets, you know.
So you were in the Israeli military, but you were really not what we would call a soldier or a combat person. You were an entertainer.
Right.
You were an entertainer. Mm-hmm. And that's where you got your acting chops.
No, then I went to the, after I studied since I was 13, then I went to the most prestigious acting school.
Which, by the way?
It's called Nissan Atib.
Say it again.
Nissan Atib.
And you studied acting, seriously?
Right, 3 years, yeah.
For 3 years?
Yeah.
Let's underscore
three
that.
Three very intense years of studying was very, very serious for me.
What was your first professional job?
Oh, the first professional job actually was before I was, I got into the army. I did this movie. That was my first movie. And actually I did it as I was in the army because I remember that I was so excited about participating in the first movie that I felt like I'm a superstar. And I called the director from the military, the director from the theater, and I said, "Well, I'm so sorry, but I have to have wardrobe session right now. I can't come to rehearsal."
What was the name of the movie?
Something ridiculous. I can't remember. It was really stupid.
It was your first movie. Did you get the taste for it?
Yeah. It was great. I loved it.
Did you know then you wanted a theatrical career?
Yeah, I mean, I wanted to just, at that age, I wanted to act. Every door pretty much was open for me in Israel. It was like a green light. So as a student, I was always, everyone was starting getting nervous, getting towards the third year, what theater is going to pick them up. So I was very lucky to get two offers from the two main theaters. And two very interesting roles. One of the roles was the role of, I can't remember the name of the character, but in Closure, the play. And yes. Then the other role was an original piece, an Israeli piece. And it won Best Comedy, the equivalent for Tony. And I won the equivalent for Tony in Israel for that.
You won the Israeli equivalent mm-hmm. of the Tony Awards.
Right. For my first role that I was
doing. And the Tony Awards are the Academy Awards of Acting. It puts in on the East Coast of New York. New York. It's pretty impressive.
Yeah, I mean, it felt, it was a good start. Because that was the first thing I did. And as I was doing that show, I was called to be Juliet in Romeo and Juliet in another theater.
So you had gone in a very short period of time to the top of the parade. Tell me about some of those accomplishments. Tell me how many, what it did.
The nice thing about it was my first roles that I was doing that caught the attention or just brought me or put me on the map in kind of front of the line of the Israeli industry. So it was the theater role that I did, the first role that I did in theater, and then the first roles that I did on in the movies, I got the Israeli Oscar nomination. That's just the facts of what happened.
You got nominated for the equivalent of the Israeli Oscars.
The first part I was acting in a movie, I was, my character was called Efrat. It was in a movie called Giraffes. And I had to cut my hair short in black. And it was basically a woman that accidentally, hurt somebody with her car, basically ran over somebody and killed him. So instead of going to the police, she decided to change her identity and becoming a French artist.
Yves, c'est très joli pour promener à la...
L'orangerie.
À l'orangerie, oui. You like it? La chambre.
Oui, oui, ça me plaît beaucoup.
So that was the first role that I was acting in. And for that, I got the nomination for the equivalent for Oscar in Israel.
Wow.
And the second role that I did was of a woman that fall in love, Israeli woman that fall in love with an Arabic Bedouin. And they have this very passionate, wild relationship. And just as part of tradition, once she became his wife, he takes her and kind of force her to go through clitorectomy. So that was the second role that I did in the movies, and I also got the equivalent of Oscar nomination.
How do I look?
You are very beautiful. Now you put this. No, no, here, like this. Here you are.
Your second Israeli Oscar nomination.
Mm-hmm. At that time, it didn't matter much to me. Every time that I needed to go to give an award or get an award, always seems to me like a big distraction. But it was just nice to be embraced by the Israeli industry so fast with every first role that I did in kind of every media. It just attracted a lot of attention. So that was the fun part about it, I guess.
You when I was ready to kill myself. I called people in a phone book. You're the only one who responded.
Yes, I was very intrigued. And I have no life.
What do you mean, no life?
I'm just marking time. I don't know where to go because I don't see the point. I don't understand the game.
What game?
You know.
You mean life?
Yes. You took me out of that.
Out of what?
Out of it being an effort. I was curious and I was eager to see you. My life obtained a purpose. I felt alive.
Oh, that's good.
No kidding.
I'm glad I was able to do something good for you.
Well, don't stop now.
I'm trying to. I called you, didn't I?
But I want to be with you. Why won't you let me?
What do you expect us to do? Take off our clothes, get naked, and...
Make love.
You became famous in Israel. Mm-hmm. Became a big deal. Mm-hmm. Everybody knew who you were as an actress. There must have come an offer from Showtime.
Oh, for the show Weeds? Actually, the way it happened was that the movie that I did got Sandbox, it was called, that was the second movie. It made its way to America and won this very esoteric festival that was existed maybe for 1 or 2 years. It's called Manchester, so it won that festival. and people from one of the studios here, Focus Features, were seeing my performance there, and then I came here to a film festival and I met with them. And so I started just getting some feedback from America, and people just started hearing about me. So then I came here to do a show, an off-Broadway show. And I wasn't really planning to do it, but I kind of, pretty much I did everything in Israel. I did TV, I did the equivalent for Ugly Betty. I wasn't Ugly Betty, but it was one of the main characters.
מה שלומך, מר מלאדה?
מה שלומך אתה? קרקר?
קרקר?
מר מלאדה על קרקר, אני מה זה מתה על זה?
הבנתי אותך. מר מלאדה על קרקר.
So I would be on TV, theater every night, and I was just curious about the rest of the world, because I never had time to take time off in my career, and it was pretty much a lot of intense work.
כשהייתי ילדה הייתי אומרת עם אבא שלי תפילת שחרית.
ברוך אתה, השם אלוקינו, מלך העולם, אשר נתן לסחבי בינה להבחין בין יום ובין לילה.
בוקר אחד אבא שלי אומר, ברוך שלא עשה אני אישה. אמרתי לו, הייתי ילדה קטנה, כן? מה זה ברוך שלא עשה אני אישה? אז אבא אומר, אם את רוצה, את יכולה להגיד ברוך שעשה אני כרצונו. אמרתי לו.
So, in the first kind of chance I got to go to this film festival, and I did that, and that's when I met this woman that offered me to come to do an off-Broadway show. And first I thought, I'm never gonna work in an off-Broadway show anymore, but we read that. It was just the day before I left from New York. I called her the last minute, because the same girl in my childhood that because of her I started studying acting at the age of 13, I met the same girl on the plane on my way to the film festival. And I haven't seen her in many years at that point. And she was very happy to see me, and we were just catching up and talking about everything. And she said, you know, a friend of mine is going to do this off-Broadway show called Blood Wedding by Lorca. So I was like, what is off-Broadway? Like, what do you mean? She's like, well, there's Broadway, there's off-Broadway, and then off-Broadway. Like, do they pay? She said, no. So I'm like, I don't do work like that anymore. I'm done with that. So she said, look, she's so talented. She just graduated Columbia University. Why don't you take the number? And why don't you just call her, just meet with her? So I'm like, no. She's just, you know what? Let me just write it down in yours. So she just forced me to take her number down. So I had this little notebook, and it was my trip notebook. And the day before I left, I was just looking through the notebook, and I saw this little name, and I was like, okay, I'll give her a call. So I called the girl and I said, hi, Karen, this is Maytal. I'm a friend of Noah, and I'm an actor, and she gave me your number. And she was like, oh, okay, Maytal. Why don't you tell me what you did, or what do you... So I'm like, well, I was in this, and I was in that, and I was in this show. And she was like, well, there was only one Maytal in that show. It's Maytal Dohan. So I was like, yeah, it's me. So that's that worked for my advantage, that the girl was my fan. So she said, why don't you come and do that role of the bride in Blood Wedding? And I read the text, and it was gorgeous poetry. And I went back to Israel, and she called and she said, would you consider coming here to New York and do the show? And I was like, I just thought to myself, why not? So that's kind of was the time that I packed a small suitcase and to
took a break from the theater for the first time and came to New York.
How did you get Weeds?
I just auditioned, basically.
You just walked in, you auditioned, and the producer said,
yeah,
I want you to be in our TV series.
Yeah.
Showtime.
Mm-hmm.
I think God has a different plan for me.
What are you saying?
I'm saying now that I'm partially toeless, there's no way I can be sent to Iraq. So I'm thinking God wants me to do something else besides study for the rabbinate. I'm thinking maybe he wants me to open a microbrewery or day trade in oil futures.
You can't commit to anything, can you?
Don't say that. I'm committed to you. Nothing's changing between us.
Ow!
I trusted you. I put my job on the line. I thought you had ruach.
I have tons of ruach. I'm filled with it. No ruach.
You scrawny, selfish little pig. I did everything for you.
God!
Fuck! Quit it.
That dog should have bitten your dick off.
You were in an American television series nationally. People began to take stock of you and recognize you. You had come off of an enormously successful acting career in Israel. You were nominated for awards that the equivalent of which in America were among the most significant in the industry. There came a time where you decided you wanted to sing.
Well, I would sing in my show Bath Party, or I did this show with a very well-known Israeli singer named Ivri Lider. So we did a kind of a duet cabaret show in Israel. And I would sing as part of soundtrack for movies or for theater shows. But I never thought I'm gonna pursue it professionally until I was 3 years ago, actually. It was in September 2009 or so. I was pursued by the production of Dancing with the Stars in Israel a few times to be part of the show in Israel. And it was just when the reality or just these kind of contest shows started, and at least in Israel, and I didn't think it was really appropriate for me as a serious actress to be in a show like that. So I refused. I never wanted to accept the offer for the few years. And finally, in 2009, I just finished a Sony web series called Woke Up Dead. And I got the call again to be on the Dancing with the Stars in Israel. And after a little bit of negotiation, I said again, like, it's just not for me. And after I said no, it just kind of stayed in my mind. And really all I wanted is to just take a break from America. So I said yes. I called and they say, you know what, we almost announce everyone. We're going to whatever, change something around. And we're so happy you're finally saying yes. So I went to Israel to do the show, and I have a great spiritual guide. I mean, at least I thought she was great until this point. Let's see if all this advice were right. As I was doing the show, I would see her in person. This is a woman that I met when I started my acting career in Israel. I saw her again when I was doing the show, and she said, at one point, she just said, so now it's the time for you to start your career as a singer. You have to go back to the US ASAP, and you're gonna become a singer now. So it totally didn't make any sense for me.
Who said that to you?
My spiritual guide.
I never intrude, I ask. No names. Take us as deeply or in shallow waters. You say your, quote, spiritual guide told you to go back to America and pursue a singing career.
Mm-hmm.
However you wish to phrase it or describe it, tell us about your spiritual guide.
Well, she's a very, very special woman. I think she is really just gifted. She has a brilliant intuition and just brilliant understanding about people and about the world. And I met her years ago when I started my acting career. So my girlfriend told me about this woman. She doesn't really call herself a psychic. So the best way to describe it is, I guess, spiritual guide, because she's not a psychologist, she's not a psychic, she's not a psychiatrist. So I don't know what to call it.
Does she use any of the commonly known devices, like tarot cards?
No, she doesn't do any of that. She basically just talks to you and tells you about your role on this planet and just kind of helps you.
Would you say that you believed that she can see the future?
Well, what happened with her was that I saw her before my career started. I saw her just one time. And she basically described to me what's gonna happen, including me becoming a singer and coming to America and everything. And that was years before.
Your spiritual guide told you to return to America
mm-hmm.
and begin a singing career.
Mm-hmm.
What happened?
I started arguing with her. I told her it doesn't make any sense in the world that I've been an actor and that's what I do. And she said, no, it's just all gonna happen. It's all gonna happen really fast. And I just thought she doesn't make any sense. So I said, who am I going to talk to? Because I don't know anyone from the music industry. So she said, well, you're going to meet this person. She described him to me. And I asked her, where am I going to meet him? And she said, well, I don't know where you're going to meet him. So she left me basically very baffled. I came back to New York and I was sitting with my best friend at the time, and I was literally crying. I was like, what does this woman want from me? She's driving me crazy. Because at that time, I already had the experience with her that she's just tuning into this amazing knowledge, and I experienced that everything she told me before kind of came to fruition. So I felt like I needed to just listen to her once again, which really bothered me because I didn't know anyone and I just felt like, basically I felt like an idiot. So we made 3 phone calls. I told my friend, I'm not gonna pay anyone. Like, let's just forget about that. If I'm gonna be singing right now or trying to sing, I just wanna meet somebody really, really qualified that believes in me. Otherwise, I'm not gonna chasing it. So I gave it a shot. We made 3 phone calls. The first person was a young musician, and of course they wanted to get paid. I was like, no. Second person, very nice guy, producer, again wanted to get paid. I said, not right. The third person, we came here to LA, and we heard about him from some friend. He knew me from Weeds, and he said, I'd like to meet Maytal. So we came to his office. It was a 3-floor studio. We came in, and I just saw him, and I kind of fell in love with him the minute that I saw him. And I played him a little bit of my music that I kind of did from like old days, whatever, with like some DJ friends or whatever, or for a show. And he was just saying, yeah, great, let's start working together. Let's start recording some music. So he, and the thing is, he basically was kind of like looking like whatever my healer was describing as. So I was like, wow, I guess that's a person that I'm supposed to work with. That's cool. Okay. Not too shabby. It was basically, I came back. I remember it was December. We were starting to make phone calls in December, and in January I met the third person. And his name is Che Pope. So he goes by two names, Che Pope and Che Vicious. And my friend was looking him up a little bit. And after a few sessions in the studios, basically my friend came to me and said, you know, I Googled Che that we started working with, and apparently he's like, he worked with Lauryn Hill and Fugees and Dr. Dre and 50 Cent and Eminem. And then we started talking to Che, and Che's with Dr. Dre in the studio, and he'll be right back. And I'm like, yeah, not too shabby, huh?
It's not like, too shabby.
So, that's kind of how it started.
You recorded your first single. Moderate success. Then you recorded your second single, Anya.
Mm-hmm.
And all hell broke loose. Can you recall the process of what happened when Anya was released?
How would you describe your music? How would you describe the sound?
My music is different types of electropop, from dance to trap to lounge music.
And of course, some are calling this brash young lady the Israeli Lady Gaga.
Have you gotten the comparisons to Lady Gaga a lot?
Yeah. I mean, in my mind, it was just released. I mean, it wasn't even released in the UK. I mean, I guess, Anya featuring Sean Kingston.
Along with being a performer and a singer, mm-hmm, and a musician and an author, you really have some comedy.
Yeah.
By the way, who kissed you right here?
It was my old boyfriend.
Your old, can you guys tell
he
that?
He left me, and I had to leave it as a memory.
Oh.
You
know?
The director, Ray Kay, created the video, so it had just interesting people kind of involved in the project.
Girl, need to be with Kingston, drop top, phantom, when the sun come. Real old boy, you'll be number one. Don't stop till the hook come.
Before it's released in the UK, it charted 5 on the UK chart. So that's pretty cool for somebody that just had her second single ever out in the market. So I was pretty pleased with that. But it's still an early day for the track.
Not only did Anya reach number 5 in the UK dance chart, but your YouTube hits exceeded 4 million. You were being booked in clubs around the world. You were being sought out by other producers and other people who wanted to work with you.
Correct.
You've been approached to do a reality television show. You're about to start a European concert career. You're leaving in a week or so from now to do shows in different places in the United States. You have become a serious musical presence. Am I exaggerating or am I giving you fact?
I mean, that's a true fact.
stick with me. What I said was fact.
Yeah.
Does this surprise you?
Yeah, I mean, it's great. I'm still transitioning to be a singer. So I'm very, very happy with everything that's happening. I really love this new media of the music world. I really love the people in the music industry. I mean, it's funny how a lot of people from the music industry always imagine that the film industry is some fantastic industry.
They want to act, they want to produce, they want to
direct. They just like, oh, the music industry is sad. Sure. We want to go to the film industry.
Yeah.
But the truth is that the music industry is just much more entrepreneurial minded and just kind of inviting people to break boundaries and to push boundaries and just kind of for creation and for liberation, artistic liberation. While I feel like in the movie world is just Hollywood is much more conservative. I feel like when Hollywood are making any decisions about casting, usually they just look at what the person did recently, while in the music, many times they're just looking at the potential the person has. What can the person become? I also just felt like as an actor, as a foreign actor in America, people will always just be terrified to look at what's so different about me than the girl next door. They'll be like, oh my gosh, her accent. She has an accent, you know? And as a new singer, everyone just wanna see how crazy you are and how funny you are and how can you do everything that other people don't dare to do. So it's just kind of great that through the music, I was able to express my artistic self.
The doors are wide open. And this is your ticket to ride. And although you are an actress, actor, and although that will always be part of your experience, you are now on the threshold of this gigantic musical breakthrough. Dozens of reviews from very credible sources that have even suggested that you could be in position to be the next Lady Gaga. Mm-hmm. That's pretty overwhelming stuff. Do you recognize the value and the significance of all of this?
Yeah, I mean, I recognize the significance. I feel like as everything else in life, once you see the potential, you also see the risk. Like, we have all this great potential. What if it's not going to happen? It's kind of almost the same thing.
Answer the question that you just raised. What if it's not going to happen? What's the worst case scenario?
Well, the worst case scenario in my case, which might not be a worst case scenario, but just from my perspective, I growing up in a Middle Eastern European culture, I'm missing that type of kind of loving relationships or deeper relationships and that's surrounded around families and values and just friends. So I really love the world. I'm really happy to be part of like worldwide industry. It feels great to have all this respect and great quotes and critics and all these great expectations for me. But I also just feel like I miss my friends, I miss my family. I kind of miss my old life as an Israeli person. Because here in LA, the values of family and love are not priority for people.
So when I look at you and say, in the wake of the success and standing on the threshold, and ask you, what's the downside? What's the negative? I don't want to put words in your mouth again, but are you saying that the downside would be tremendous public success and accomplishment and the loss of values, real friendships, relationships, mm-hmm. isolation, and what happens to people when they seem to inherit all of their professional dreams and leave behind all the matters of the heart and soul? Is that the downside?
Yeah, I mean, it's a downside for me from just, I mean, Tel Aviv and LA are very similar in sense of there is a similar weather. People live in sometimes in private houses and it's kind of spread it out. But the core of the values and how people relate to each other is so tremendously different that I'm kind of trying to just compare between what I, if it's worth it or not to just even be, you know, continue with this dream or continue with that mission or with that destiny. And then you ask yourself, okay, if it's my destiny, I guess, then I should stick around and I should be here because that's what I'm supposed to be doing. And when your destiny is your destiny, you also don't have the other alternatives open for you because you're supposed to stick to one. You're just trying to follow your path. So that's pretty much what I'm doing. I mean, I'm very happy and I'm having fun creatively and I'm following my path, but I haven't seen my family in a year and a half. Since Dancing with the Stars, since I was having this conversation with my guide, spiritual guide, since then I really was in Israel 4 years. Four days in 3 years because I became so busy. So it's also great, but it's also need to make sense.
In your case, it's not a fear of failure. It's a fear of the implications of success.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's combined. It's the fear of the implications of success. It's also fear of there's something about people who live in Hollywood. People come here from all over the world to achieve their dreams. And at the end of the day, I do think it's a destiny because the whole like idea about people manifesting their life is so trendy these days. Everyone thinks that they're, you know, they're going to take a piece of paper, write every day that they're going to be the king of, of Lebanon or Arabic Saudi. And it's just going to happen because they're going to write it down on the piece of paper and they're going to put out like a piece of like a palace with them inside it, and they're going to put it on the refrigerator. They're going to stare at it every day as they're reading their paper, and they're going to become kings. And it's really nice, this whole like new techniques of manifestation and positive thinking. It's great, but it's also, I think for some degree, it's a little dangerous because not everyone can get what they want in life. And this is just the very, very sad reality. You can really work hard and try to get what you want, but the truth is just really small amount of the people on this planet live completely their life they would like to live. I just want to, in my life, I just kind of like to see, okay, I like to get clear messages from the universe. about what my role is. What am I supposed to be doing on this planet? So I just feel 100% good that the sacrifice I do in my personal life are made for the right reason.
For a sense of direction, for a sense of clarification, for a sense of career guidance, the long and winding road led you to my front door. And I presume that you will come to me tonight to talk about where you go from here, what you should do, and how we get there. Is that correct?
Absolutely.
Do I have to do?